start with the actual lecture itself, I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself. I was born in Bosnia and I grew up in Bosnia. Eventually made it to Australia, where I received my PhD back in 2010. And most of my work on Islam has been in relation to theorizing of what I refer to as progressive Islam. The talk that I'm going to deliver this afternoon is actually based primarily on my recently published book on the imperatives of progressive Islam, which is the second book that I actually published on progressive Islam. My PhD was also written basically on the topic of progressive Islam. So I've had a long-standing interest in the topic, and I am, as someone who considers himself to be a follower of the Islamic message, progressive Islam goes well beyond my professional interest and informs my personal life as well. In many ways, I live and breathe progressive Islam. So I'm delighted that I have the opportunity to talk about my pet subject, and hopefully you will find it informative. And I look forward to any questions that you might have. So what's going to happen is I'm actually going to deliver a proper lecture where I'll be reading off my lecture notes. I think it's going to take about 45 minutes or so. I will try to provide a general overview of what I consider to be the imperatives of progressive Islam. And then hopefully, if you have any more specific questions, things that need clarifying, we have sufficient time to decide for this purpose. So the lecture, I will start by providing an overview of the major themes that in the main architects of progressive Islam and main theoretical architects, I should mention. I will go on into explaining as to why the word progressive Islam. I get a lot of questions as to why is it that you're using this particular descriptor. So I will try and explain as to what are some of the reasons why I am insisting on this adjective progressive in front of Islam, and what does it signify. And the majority of the talk will be dedicated to a description and a discussion of the normative imperatives of progressive Islam, followed by a brief conclusion. So, as a male person of Muslim background, and as I said, I am Bosnian Muslim by birth, and as someone who became of age at the time of the tragic events of 9/11, I have sought ways to understand my faith that is affirmative of goodness and love, as well as open to potential goodness and love in every human being. This search set me off on a journey that eventually saw me embark upon a career in academia, and eventually dedicate much of my career to theorizing of progressive Islam. The fruits of this labor of love include two books, the second of which, The Imperatives of Progressive Islam, was published earlier this year. So in today's lecture, by drawing on this scholarship of mine, I will provide an overview of the worldview underpinning progressive Islam, its approach to conceptualizing and interpreting the Islamic tradition, and its theology. The main part of the talk will describe what I term the normative imperatives of progressive Islam, and in doing so, I wish to present a less well-known, but no less authentic, understanding of Islam that hopefully will challenge what many non-Muslims and Muslims think about what Islam was, is, and ever potentially can ever be. Progressive Islam is an umbrella term covering approaches to the Islamic tradition and modernity, which employ the words progressive or at times critical when self-labeling themselves, or which fall into progressive Islam as I define it in my publications. The main theoreticians behind this contemporary Muslim thought are academics and public intellectuals from both Muslim majority and Muslim minority contexts, and include scholars such as Hassan Hanafi from Egypt, Enes Karic from Bosnia, Ali Ashkanjiya from India, Nur Polish Majid, the late Nur Polish Majid from Indonesia, Sadia Sheikh, Ibrahim Musa, and Farid Ressa from South Africa, Zibabel Husseini, Mohsen Kadibar from Iran, Mohammed Abdel Al-Jabri from Morocco, Hashim Kamali from Afghanistan, Keisha Ali from the United States, Khalid Abu al-Fadl from Egypt, but he's currently also in the United States, to name but prominent few. Now, the reason why I wanted to provide you with specific names and where they come from is to demonstrate this diversity of thought. Importantly, progressive Muslim academics and intellectuals include a significant number of females. And progressive Muslim thought has also a global grassroots activist presence associated with organizations such as Muslims for Progressive Values, Musawa, and other like-minded movements. In terms of its overall worldview, progressive Islam is best characterized by its commitment and fidelity to certain ideals, values, practices, and objectives that are expressed and take form in a number of different themes that you have here on this slide. These themes primarily concern issues pertaining to progressive Muslims' critical positioning in relation to the hegemonic capitalist, economic, political, social, and cultural forces emanating from the global north that are underpinned by neoliberal capitalist worldview. Progressive Muslims also critically position themselves in relation to hegemonic, patriarchal, exclusivist, and ethically ossified interpretations of their own inherited Islamic intellectual tradition. And they also critically position themselves both in relation to the values underpinning the Age of Enlightenment modernity, as well as radical forms of postmodern thought. So this multiple critique simultaneously, therefore, challenges both traditional and Puritan Islamic hegemonic discourses on many issues, including the debates on modernity, human rights, gender equality and justice, democracy, and the place and the role of religion in society and politics, as well as their certain Western-centric conceptualizations and interpretations of these, embedded as they are in worldview assumptions underpinning the European Enlightenment. One of the main concepts permeating progressive Muslim thought is the centrality of spirituality and the nurturing of interpersonal relationships based on Sufi-like ethical, moral, spirituality, and philosophy. By this I mean an intellectualized form of Sufism, and without the accompanying misogynist and highly hierarchical elements present in much of the pre-modern and neo-pre-modern Sufi tradition. Moreover, progressive Muslims emphasize God's universal nature and the universality of the faith itself through demonstrating God's concern for humanity in general, which, as I will outline below, leads to them to embracing of religious pluralism. Bringing about and strengthening the multifaceted and dynamic aspects of the inherited Islamic tradition, and resisting its reductionism and exclusivist interpretations founded on patriarchy, misogyny, and religious bigotry, is an important additional trait underpinning the worldview of progressive Islam. Progressive Muslims are also very critical of the hegemony of the modern free market-based economics and the political and social structures institutions and powers that support, maintain, and are not critical of the unjust status quo. Often progressive Muslims consider their use the word empire to signify these forces. So the empire, this is because the empire is considered to have brought about the transformation and the reduction of a human, a carrier of God's spirit, into a primarily economic consumer, producing great economic disparities between the majority world of the poor South and the minority world of the rich North. Progressive Muslims also wish to shift the current discourses on jihad from being primarily embedded in overtly geopolitical and security and terrorist-related analytical and conceptual matrices to that of inner intellectual and ethical and principally non-violence-based struggle and resistance to forces that conflict with their overall worldview. Progressive Muslims consider the nature of the concept of the Islamic tradition, intellectual tradition, to be a dynamic, humanly constructed product of many past and present communities of interpretation. The concept of cultural religious authenticity in progressive Muslim thought is not based upon a literal clinging to the Islamic tradition, but on a creative, critical engagement with it. In this sense, progressive Islam can be conceptualized as a form of critical Islamic traditionalism. Furthermore, progressive Islamic consciousness is firmly rooted in the Islamic tradition and is uncompromisingly cosmopolitan in its outlook. Importantly, the theory and practice of progressive Islam has the ability to redefine the very meaning of Islam in the light of late modernity without abandoning the parameters of their faith. Progressive Muslims' approach to and engagement with modernity is also characterized by an attempt to problematize the history of the debate between Islam and modernity, or Islam and West, which conceptualizes the two as being mutually exclusive. Moreover, progressive Muslims' understanding of the historical processes leading to modernity in the West considers them a result of transcultural and intercivilizational processes, thereby challenging the often made claim that modernity is a purely Western civilizational product. Therefore, in this sense, progressive Islam is not Western because it refuses to engage in this dichotomous thinking. Apologies, I'm behind in my slides. Now, why progressive and progressive Islam? So I have painted a broad brush situating progressive Islam and where it kind of stands vis-a-vis other major discursive traditions. Obviously, I only have limited space to do so. In my books, I engage with these ideas and concepts much more deeply, of course. So, as I said, often when I engage in both academic and non-academic discussions on progressive Islam, I'm asked, why do you use the adjective progressive? There are a number of reasons for that. In my actual scholarship on progressive Islam, I provide systematic philosophical, hermeneutical, and methodological explanations as to what is meant by the concept of progress in progressive Islam. But given the nature of today's lecture, let me just touch upon some of these. The concept of progress in progressive Islam is conceptualized in form of possibility and not inevitability of change. In other words, progressive Muslim thought does not subscribe to the idea of Eurocentric Age of Enlightenment approach to progress as a deterministic process, but rather to the idea that progress, including moral progress, is possible in a variety variety of different forms and from different sources. Therefore, progressive modes of thought breaks away from unilinear conceptualizations of progress, either in their Western scientific, political, or philosophical dimensions. The idea of progress in progressive Islam also signifies that ethical values like justice and fairness do not remain frozen in time. They, as collective human experience testifies, are, in principle, subject to change as God's creative powers have a direct bearing on our own collective reason and our own collective ethical moral compass. Progressive Muslim thought considers that it is the role of every individual to ever more faithfully approximate the divine as source of absolute beauty, justice, and mercy, and that this is only possible if our ethical systems do not remain frozen, as in the case of traditionalist and non-traditionalist approaches to Islamic tradition. As such, progressive Islam theorizes Islamic theology, ethics, and law in such a manner to allow space for ethical moral progress and improvement in the never-ending quest for ethical perfection. Another reason why progressive Muslim thought employs the term progressive is to highlight the strong affinities in the kind of theologies and philosophies and interpretational approaches and the socio-political and ethical values that exist among progressive religious or spiritual movements worldwide, such as the network of spiritual progressives. My last night's talk was on the network of spiritual progressives, which is a network that, although it's based in the United States, its vision and its relevance is global, and I would strongly recommend that you check them out. So these are some of the reasons why I insist on the word progressive, progressive Islam. And finally, the one that I did not mention is that in progressive Muslims subscribe to the idea that the Quran and Sunnah, the normative teachings of Islam, although they were not able to realize the kind of moral and ethical trajectories that they were pointing to, let me put it this way. The idea of progress also comes from the fact that the moral vision of the most foundational Islamic text, the Quran, when it was revealed, it was progressive in its nature. In other words, it was ahead of its time. So, given the context in which it was revealed, so progressive Muslims want to continue with this progressive vision of the sacred scripture, keeping in mind that this progressive vision in different means a different thing in different contexts. Now, let me come to the main part of my talk and the idea of the imperatives of progressive Islam. Now, having briefly explained the concept of progress in progressive Islam, let me move on to what I term the imperatives of progressive Islam. By the concept of imperative in progressive Islam, I refer to certain theological, moral, and ethical principles that ought to guide principled actions of those who believe in the Islamic message. Importantly, however, these normative imperatives are considered to be applicable to all humanity, since they are premised on the belief in pre-theoretical and pre-conventional concepts of truth and justice that do not presuppose faith. In the context of Islam as a religious tradition, this translates itself in the idea of Islam being an ethical religious worldview whose anchoring value is the idea of what could be termed the ethics of responsibility, in which humans, as stewards of God's creation, have the responsibility to act justly and fight for justice, even if it's against their own self-interests. here's an overview of the imperatives, and I will be talking about each one of them in some detail. So the very first imperative is what I call creative or critical and innovative thought based on epistemological openness and methodological fluidity. Now, by this I mean that the proponents of progressive Islam do not subscribe to commonly employed dichotomies such as tradition versus modernity, secularism versus religion, or simplistic generalizations such as modernity equals West, that modernity equals or should be reduced to just its Western or Judeo-Christian intellectual civilization tradition. As such, the proponents of progressive Islam are engaged in permanent dialogue with the progressive agendas of other cultures, drawing inspiration not only from movements that are premised outside, drawing inspiration not only from faith-based liberatory movements, such as liberation theology, but also from movements that are premised outside of a faith-based framework, such as secular humanism or non-theistic philosophies of the East. I refer to this aspect of progressive Muslim thought as epistemological openness and methodological fluidity. This is in contrast to non-progressive-based approaches to the Islamic tradition, whose worldview and the very concept of the Islamic tradition itself is premised on what could be called epistemological arrest and methodological closure. According to these approaches, Islamic authenticity is locked in the past, and the past is constantly imposing itself onto the present, leaving little or no room for meaningful and consequential creative and innovative thought. Moving on to the second imperative, Islamic liberation theology. Progressive Muslim scholars consider theology of liberation to be an absolute imperative for Muslims living in the current socio-political and wider geopolitical context. The reason for the need to develop and subscribe to Islamic liberation theology included the traumatic legacy of colonialism, the growing gap between rich and poor in general, and between rich and poor Muslims in particular, aggressive spread of forms of Islamic puritanism and fundamentalism, and their alliance with imperialist capitalism, and the political, economic, and social impotence of various modernist as well as conservative mainstream forms of political Islam. In fact, the emergence of Islamic liberation theology as conceptualized by progressive Muslim scholars has been inspired in significant part through their engagement with the pioneers of liberation theology in the Christian majority world context, such as scholars such as Gustavo Gutierrez, Torres, and Michael Wolff, to name but the most prominent few. Shafiq Akhtar, one of the main proponents and pioneers of Islamic liberation theology, goes as far as to suggest that Islamic liberation theology is an actual fact and Islamization of Christianity. This stands as a very pertinent example of progressive Muslim thought finding inspiration in movements and schools of thought that are not necessarily part of the historical experience of Islam's concrete historical trajectory, but which are considered as being in accordance with its overall worldview, ideals, and objectives. Much like the Christian liberation theology counterparts in whose work they find sources of inspiration, progressive Muslim scholars consider faith to be an indispensable and vital stimulus for struggle against oppression and injustice at the grassroots level. These scholars have moved away from many aspects of mainstream accommodationist interpretations of Islamic theology, which are irreconcilable with the ideals, values, and objectives of Islamic liberation theology that I outlined earlier. As a result, progressive Muslim scholars have engaged in systematic and creative efforts to reinterpret, on the basis of ontologies and hermeneutics. Many fundamental concepts of the creed, in order to reflect their commitment to theology of liberation, including fundamental theological concepts. For example, in Islamic liberation theology, the concept of revelation is not a theocentric but anthropocentric concept, which brings humanity rather than God into full historical limelight as subject of study. Moreover, the so-called five pillars of Islam are considered as religious in their form, but in terms of their content as political in nature, as they imply free will, freedom to act, responsibility for one's actions, and hence the need to establish justice and apply justice. For example, the concept of Tawheed, which is one of the most fundamental concepts in Islamic theology that is usually understood as merely a theological concept describing divine unity, is considered to be an action-oriented belief system which affirms emancipatory and liberatory practices of the entire humankind and resists oppression, tyranny, and injustice. Engaging in a quintessentially progressive Islam's multiple critique, progressive Muslim scholars are also relentlessly scrutinizing all forces and structures responsible for perpetuation of oppression and injustice, regardless of whether these emanate from outside of the Islamic tradition or from within it, and irrespective of the race, ethnic, or gender-based identities of the victims. Progressive Islamic theology as Islamic liberation theology therefore gives priority to orthopraxis over orthodoxy. For this type of theology, the human and the human condition are central to it. Furthermore, this theology holds that humans are considered to experience the divine most readily and most immediately through the interactions with other human beings, rather than by contemplating abstractly on the divine, observing the nature, or engaging in various spiritual exercises. Furthermore, progressive Muslim theological orientation favors inductive over deductive reasoning because its foundation and starting point is the world of the human condition with its incredible diversity and complexity, which makes it very difficult to think in binary terms, such as having salvation or not having salvation. In addition, it is more likely, this type of theology is more likely to be open to and accommodating of the idea of religious pluralism. There is the premise that none of the ratified religious traditions made the crucible of history are capable of objectively and fully capturing the divine. Therefore, none can claim a monopoly over God. This in turn translates into the premise that the idea or the concept of God is not fully graspable to the human intellect, either through his or her intellect, mind, or to use the Sufi analogy, their hearts. By definition, such a theological orientation also implies that the sacred scriptures cannot offer us humans an unequivocal, clearly accessible, and once and for all valid understanding of God through the simple process of reading or interpretation. Instead, it considers the human interpreter and his or her subjectivities and contingencies as most significantly determinative of the process of interpretation, envisaged as a never-ending dynamic process that continually evolves with reason. There is, in other words, an organic and dialectical relationship between revelation and reality. Furthermore, this theology gives precedence to reason-based ethics over law. It insists that law must be in constant service of ethics, and that law ought to evolve with evolving ideas about ethics as developed by humanity. And in the post-revelatory period, this evolution is exclusively pluralism, diversity, and what's fundamental to all of it, uncertainty. Moving on to the next imperative, the human rights-based approaches to the Islamic tradition. The last 3 to 4 decades have witnessed an increasing internationalization of human rights discourse as a global platform for the contemporary language of progressive politics and its focus on eradication of all types of inequalities, which perpetuate or all are complicit in the perpetuation of various social injustices around the world. The question of the compatibility of Islam and human rights at a theoretical and conceptual level has been a prominent theme in this regard. Speaking in broad terms, progressive Muslim scholars approach the issue of compatibility or the relationship between modern human rights discourse and the Islamic tradition by placing both in a historical perspective. In agreement with the proponents of non-Western forms of human rights schemes, such as that of Boaventura de Santos, progressive Muslim scholars are engaged in developing a theoretical framework for a constructive encounter between two human rights schemes at the level of abstract concepts. In doing so, progressive Muslim scholars seek to weave the ethos and the culture of human rights discourse into the social and cultural fabric of Muslim-majority societies in order for the same to be more effectively realized in the political and legal realms of these societies. As such, progressive Muslim scholars are interested in engendering human rights schemes which are sensitive to the historical, ethical, and religious sentiments of Muslims, but which, at the conceptual level, are in agreement with or compatible with those of the modern human rights schemes. In other words, progressive Muslim thinkers aim to theoretically affirm the conceptual compatibility between Islamic doctrine and the modern human rights schemes. But for this to take place, progressive Muslim scholars highlight the importance of developing a fresh, rigorous, and systematic methodology of interpretation of the fountainheads of the Islamic worldview, the Quran and the Sunnah. This methodology is based on a rational Islamic theology and ethics that I briefly alluded to earlier, as well as on a particular conceptualization of divine ontology, whose central tenets are justice and mercy. These values, in turn, are considered to be the sources of universal moral values and are to be extended to and applicable equally to all of humanity. This is so simply on the basis that each and every human being is considered a unique creation of God, having equal moral worth, equal dignity, and equal moral agency. According to progressive Muslim scholars, this view is not only self-evident, but is also deeply embedded in the Quranic worldview itself. Therefore, each individual is entitled to enjoying the same inalienable rights, both at the level of individuals as well as members of different communities, including the political. Moving on to the next imperative, where we look at the rationalist and contextualist approaches to Islamic theology and ethics. The issue concerning the nature of social ethical norms and values and their relationship with Islamic law and jurisprudence is another prominent theme in progressive Muslim thought. In many ways, the proponents of progressive Muslim thought consider the issue of ethics in general to be one of the most pressing challenges to the Islamic tradition in the contemporary age. In order to meet these challenges, progressive Muslim scholars seek to rediscover and build further on rationalist approaches to Islamic theology and ethics that existed in the past. In order to do so, progressive Muslim scholars rely on two interpretational mechanisms. In particular, one are comprehensive contextualization and another teleological or purposive Quran Sunnah hermeneutics. Comprehensive contextualization is premised on the idea that the social and ethical legal injunctions featuring the Quran and Sunnah, such as those pertaining to gender issues, as well as the widely feared and not well understood corporal punishments, the hudud, largely reflected the prevalent customary norms, but were not initiated by the Quran and Sunnah. So they were not initiated, they were already existing, they were customary practices that existed at that time. As such, they should not be viewed as universal aspects of the Islamic message. Purposive Islamic hermeneutics begins with the belief that the social and the ethical legal elements found in the primary text of Islamic teachings, when approached holistically and contextually, point to certain moral trajectories that go beyond the immediate moral and ethical horizon within which Quran initially operated. It is these moral trajectories inform certain ethical ideals and values that Islamic ethics and law seek to fulfill and preserve, while being fully aware that these ethical values and ideals will require new articulations and conceptualizations in the light of new contexts. In this view, what was at one point customary or ethically accepted may no longer be appropriate to fulfill the Islamic ethical ideals in a new context. For example, when the Quran and Sunnah emphasize the concept of justice, this could require something different for Muslims in a world that speaks of gender, race, class, capitalism, and colonization than it did at the time of the revelation of the Quran itself. Importantly, both principles, comprehensive contextualization and teleological hermeneutics, are premised on a rationalist theology and ethics that interpretationally privilege the spirit over the letter of Islamic ethics and law. In other words, progressive Islamic hermeneutics is characterized by its emphasis on the role of the context and history in interpreting the foundational Islamic texts, without questioning their ontologically divine nature. These interpretational mechanisms, in turn, enable progressive Muslim thought to escape the hermeneutical confines of traditionalist Islamic law and ethics. Furthermore, these approaches are accommodative and exist in harmony with contemporary conceptualizations of ethical moral values, such as contemporary conceptualizations of justice and gender equality. Social and gender justice. Commitment to contemporary articulations of social and gender justice, including the theorizing of indigenous Islamic feminism, is another important pillar of progressive Muslims' approach to the Islamic tradition. In this respect, a number of progressive Muslim scholars have developed very systematic and sophisticated non-patriarchal Quran hermeneutical models which affirm gender-just interpretations of Islam and counter the prevalent patriarchal alternatives. These non-patriarchal Quran Sunnah hermeneutical models are characterized by the kind of interpretational principles I mentioned just now, things such as contextualist interpretation and teleological hermeneutics. Although acknowledging that both feminism and Islam are highly contested, evaluated concepts which elicit and hold various meanings to various actors participating in the debates on Islam and gender, progressive Muslim scholars consider that the term feminism has currency in the context of Islamic tradition for a number of reasons, including the following. Number one, the existence of Islamic feminism transcends and destroys the inaccurate and artificial conceptual dichotomies and polarities between religion and secularism, East and West, modernity and tradition, and similar others, all of which have been employed to deny rights to Muslim women. The second reason why feminism has currency in Islamic thought is the premise that they can be no long-lasting and sustainable gains in women's rights unless patriarchal notions of family and gender relations are debated, challenged, and redressed within an Islamic framework. And perhaps most importantly, progressive Muslim scholars insist on the viability of the concept of Islamic feminism because it highlights the importance of gender justice in conceptualizing Islam as a modern tradition. Finally, progressive Muslims affirm religious pluralism. Progressive Muslim scholars theorize and affirm the normative validity of pluralism, including the religious pluralism on a number of levels. These include the inescapable pluralism at level of understanding religious texts, so that is at the level of hermeneutics or scriptural reasoning, as well as at the level of religious experiences, and consider this pluralism as divinely willed. In doing so, they build further on pluralistic tendencies present in the pre-modern Islamic tradition, as for example found in the writings of Muslim sages such as Ibn Arabi and Jalaluddin Rumi. In this respect, let me quote two progressive Muslim scholars who have affirmed religious pluralism in the following manner. Professor Abdul Aziz Satedina has this to say, and I quote, "In dealing with pluralism, Islamic tradition had actually found expression in the pluralist world of religions, which it acknowledged and evaluated critically, but never rejected as simply false." Another Muslim scholar, Abdul Karim Surush, has this to say in relation to affirmation of religious pluralism, and I quote, "No one has considered the possibility that these unavoidable plurality of interpretations, conceptualizations, and sects, to which no religion is immune, might have some other meaning and significance. Maybe it means that this plurality is itself desirable. Maybe rightful guidance is broader than what we had imagined. Maybe salvation and felicity hinge on something else, something beyond the antagonistic and divisive dogmas and particular conceptualizations. If we look at things from this perspective, pluralism means nothing more than acknowledging God's boundless compassion, the triumph of prophets, the feebleness of Satan's treachery, and the extension of God's kindly hands over the heads of all the world's people." End of quote. So in a nutshell, I have attempted to outline in broad terms and describe the normative aspects of progressive Muslims' worldview. What I would like to highlight is that many of the normative imperatives that define progressive Islam were articulated and existed in pre-modern approaches to the Islamic tradition, but have been, for a number of socio-political and cultural rather than intellectual reasons, marginalized. I think it is high time for these ideas to become much more mainstream and more widely accepted among contemporary Muslims, because I and many progressive Muslim scholars are convinced that progressive Islam offers the best answers to many of the challenges that contemporary Muslims are facing, and that, along with other progressive-minded spiritual, religious, political, social, and economic progressive